Hello, New Orleans. Good morning, West Coast. Good afternoon, East Coast, and good evening, Europe. Yes, we are global right now. My name is Elisabeth Sereda. I'm an author, producer, and journalist, and almost a NOLA local. And most of all, a big fan and a big supporter of the New Orleans Film Society and the festival. I'd like to give a special welcome to the New Orleans Film Society Circle members, who are our live studio audience, and all our guests streaming from home. And now I'm very excited to welcome actor, director, writer, producer, activist, and the man with the best sense of humor. And now that I said that, he has to live up to it. And longtime friend, George Clooney. And as usual in these situations, it takes about 10 seconds. We're all getting used to that new technology.
I'm unmuted. Is that okay?
You are unmuted and you're here. Welcome. How have you been?
I've been very good. How have you been?
I'm okay, you know. It's the way it goes. Let's jump right in because you have a new movie, Midnight Sky, and we'll start streaming on Netflix in December.
Yes, we were gonna open in some theaters beforehand, but that's looking a lot less likely as we barrel towards 200,000 people a day getting infected over here.
Yeah,
where you're in Austria, right?
I am in Vienna. I'm locked down.
So and it's bad there still too, right?
Yes, yes. Yeah. So let's look at the trailer.
Come in, Ether. This is Barbo Observatory. Are you receiving this?
Is anyone out there?
This is Ether. Does any one copy? We're not receiving anything.
That puts our last contact with Mission Control at
3 weeks.
Why is it so quiet?
That's Ether. It's a spaceship that we hoped would be our future. I have to warn them about the conditions on Earth. I don't know all the details. It started with a mistake. There is an antenna that's stronger than ours. We get to that antenna, they'll hear us. Take a deep breath.
In our galaxy alone, there are billions of stars. At least one of them has the potential to support life.
I'm thinking a lot about time. Why one person lives a lifetime, and another only gets a few years.
We made a promise to our families.
You want to be an explorer?
Earth! Cut to my voice!
But while you're doing all that, your own life is just slipping away.
That's why I have to contact them. Before it's too late.
Yeah, like a happy Disney film, you know?
Yeah, it is. It's definitely that. I was lucky enough to see it already. It's called, it's called Midnight Sky, and it's based on a novel that was called Good Morning Midnight, correct?
That's right. Lily Brooks-Dalton wrote the book. It's a beautiful book. I hadn't read the book when I got the screenplay, and I read the screenplay first. There's a little bit difference. The ending is a little bit different. We had things along the way that we had to sort of alter and change, but she wrote a beautiful book. And Mark Smith, who is the screenwriter who wrote The Revenant, and he's written a lot of wonderful scripts. I've worked with him since then now on two other projects. He's just a spectacular writer. So, you know, you get to start with really good material. It's very helpful.
What was it about the story that made you want to turn it into a film?
Well, it's a funny thing. You can't, I don't want to give away all the stuff because there actually is kind of a big surprise ending and things, but there was an element of the story that was about what man is capable of doing to one another, you know, in terms of, you know, you could play all these things out, right? You could play out all this anger and hatred, and not just in the United States, which obviously is very divided right now and purposefully divided by some, but you could look at you know, Duterte in the Philippines and Bolsonaro and Orban, and you can go down the list, Putin and Erdogan, and you can feel and see all of this fomenting of hate and anger and interplay. And you could play that forward 20 or 30 years. And this isn't really science fiction at all. The idea that that we could destroy one another. That's not out of the realm. And so that was my pitch to Netflix about it, which was, it's not quite as fictional as we hope. But I also thought that the reason I loved it was there was redemption at the end of this. There is some hope. And I thought that was important, a piece of the script. Without it, I think it's just a, you know, dystopian story that doesn't, you know, I don't think anybody needs to just have right about now. This one was one that's said, you know, we're gonna somehow get through these things, or at least some of us are, you know.
It's interesting that when we see movies about the future, and we've seen them 10, 20, 30 years ago, they don't look much like the future anymore when we look at them now. I mean, a current example that comes up all the time now, obviously, is Contagion. Do you think that in terms of space travel and in terms of the state of the planet, I mean, I hope we're not heading towards 2069 Midnight Sky, but Do you think about these things?
I do. You know, the space travel stuff is interesting because basically we were using information that NASA is working on right now that would be stuff that would be built in 25 years, you know. So we weren't, that wasn't fictional either, really. We were using the basic tools of space travel that NASA is talking about. There are a couple of Hollywood tropes that have existed in films for a while, this sort of rotating gyroscope thing that's in almost every spaceship now, which could create a false gravitational pull. It can work, it just wouldn't quite work. It wouldn't be quite as simple as we've all seen them in films. And you know, there are other things like, yes, you could probably walk on, there are a couple of moons that we've seen ice surrounded and heated from the inside, but you know, walking on it, the radiation alone might, you know, burn you up pretty quickly. So there are certain things that aren't necessarily real. The atmosphere and all the things about Earth itself, you know, that's a whole other question. You know, what I'll be 60 this year, what we're leaving to our children and our grandchildren that's a whole other question, which, you know, if you go to places like, we shot in Iceland, my section of the story, which is out on this glacier, was like the second largest glacier in the world. It's not anymore. And it's, you know, it's melted to the extent, go to Iceland and ask them if there's global warming. And that's not a political question. It is just a simple answer. Or go to the Maldives, which is a very flat island, set of islands, and they're sinking, you know, because the water is rising. Go to places where they're the canary in the coal mine on global warming, and there isn't any political debate about it. It is happening. So, you know, we have an incredible storm right now going on. So, Storm Iota. So, yeah, I don't know. I think I don't think that these are all particularly, you know, it's certainly things we should be arguing about endlessly and trying to solve. You know.
Let's talk about the filming, because I remember in October of 2019, when you were in Iceland, I sent you a message asking you how you were doing. And your reply was a sort of behind the scenes video shot on your phone where you saw unrecognizable people clearly working on a film in the midst of an ice storm.
Yeah.
Was that kind of normal when you were shooting?
It was hard. We had a skeleton crew because we knew it was about 40 degrees below zero and like 60 to 70 mile an hour gusts of wind. And you want the wind because we wanted the storm vibe of it. And you could see it coming. It's like a sandstorm coming towards you. Here it comes. Everybody get ready. And we had the little Kaylin with me, who's 7 years old, you know, and she's Irish and she's tough as nails. But, you know, we'd have to do things. We'd have to tie strings to one another. And we had whistles and all these things, because once that storm came in, I couldn't see the camera crew. You couldn't see, you know, the only person I could see was Kaylin and hold her hand. And so we were always had to have something tied to the rest of the crew. The crew is very small. There may be 20 people out there, because, you know, it's, you can get lost there really quickly because you can certainly lose your way. And, you know, they last, those storms would last for, you know, 10 minutes or something. You can't stay out there the way we were dressed for 10 minutes. You know, we lasted about, you know, a minute and a half or 2 minutes. She had goggles and things, but I didn't. And so, you know, by the time we would finish a take, my eyelids would be frozen shut and I'd have to run into this truck and put the heater on my face to get my eyelashes unfrozen so that I could go back out and shoot again. You know, it's just stuff to do.
It's describe what it's like when you are basically all on your own in those scenes as an actor, and then you are the director overseeing everything and kind of directing yourself in those scenes. Is that a lonely feeling?
No, because you're never all alone. You know, if we're sitting here right now, it would look like we're all alone, but there's 40 people around, you know, making sure that everything works. There were some tricks to this one. It was harder because, I play a guy who's dying. So I lost like about 25 pounds. So I was weak, you know, weakened. And so that's good for the part. It's not good for directing, right? Because directing requires all your energy. You're the general, you're out there going, let's go do this. So the minute, you know, I'd say cut, then I'd have to, you know, get out of that mode and jump up and go, you know. And we, particularly when Iceland up there, it's all hands on deck. We're all picking up camera boxes and running to get into the, you know, to chase bad weather or chase the sunset. Or, you know, remember that particularly there, you know, we could start shooting at 11:30 in the morning. That's when the sun really was up and it was down by, you know, 2:30 or 3. So we didn't have much of a window to shoot with. So everything was, that part was pressurized, all the stuff. Kaylin's 7, so you only had a little bit of time to work with her. But that little girl was amazing. Literally everything we did was one take with her. I mean, I think I did 2 takes with her, you know, maybe 10 times. She puts to shame all other, including myself, all us actors. Because, you know, she just fakes stuff and it's perfect. You know, I go, give me your scared face. And she'd be like, oh. And you go, that's great. You know, and then she'd laugh. So she'd never acted before, but if she wants it, she will have a really wonderful career.
You have a whole group of actors that you actually like working with. You've done movies with before. Like in this film, it was Kyle.
I love working with Kyle. Kyle's one of those guys that, you know, people always want to make him Jimmy Stewart. And there's some truth in it because he is kind of the everyman. But he's a little more Spencer Tracy, too, because he's kind of grumpy, too. You know, he's always a thing, not in real life, but on camera. He's kind of like, God damn it. And it makes it so much fun. He's such a wonderful actor and everything. Kyle is a really, he simplified his the way he approaches his work in a way that I really appreciate. He comes in and is like, where do you want me? How do you want this to end? And where do you want me to start? And where do you want me to be at the end? He's worked long enough that he knows, you know, a lot of times a director is trying to get the actors, manipulate them to do these things you need. And he's like, where do you want me to start? Where do you want to end? And I'll fill in the rest. And he does it beautifully, you know.
Let me switch gears and ask you something that miraculously I've never asked you before, but we're doing this more or less in New Orleans, and yeah. You are actually a Southerner. You were born in Kentucky. Is there any part of the Southern culture that stuck with you, things that you love, whether it's music or food or drink?
All of it. Drink? Are you kidding? Who are you talking to? I'm Irish from the South. It's like it's in your baby milk when you start. Tons of things. You know, I still have a house in my hometown of Augusta, Kentucky. My mom and dad live there. My sister lives there. I have a great affinity and love for, it's funny. If you live in the area of the South, there are real sort of drawing lines, and it all goes back to the Civil War. It's a really funny thing. People say, well, you're from the South, you're from Kentucky. And Kentucky's like, not really the South. We were neutral during the Civil War, you know? So we're not really the South, you know? Below us, Tennessee's, that's the South. But we sure sound like the South, and it feels like the South. But there was, you know, there is an openness and a kindness and a generosity of spirit to most Americans, not necessarily always to all, unfortunately, but hopefully those things are constantly in search of a more perfect union, you know, and hopefully we're constantly working towards our better angels. And I've had such a great, I had great growing up there, you know. It's a town of 1,100 people, so I was the starting center on my basketball team. This may not mean much to you being from Austria, but starting centers are usually about, you know, 6 foot in high school, 6'8", 6'10". I'm 5'11". So, you know, we lost every game, but I got to start from the time I was very young. So I there were some fun adventures.
And speaking of the South, before 2020 kind of derailed all our plans, you were telling me that you had plans to possibly shoot a film in New Orleans. Is that still going to happen?
Well, not for a while. You know, the problem is now I'm going to shoot a film now, in Boston, actually, but it's a very, very, very small film with a very small cast, because that's kind of all we can do right now. You know, the other ones required a lot of background artists and a lot of, you know, just too big to handle with COVID. It's an interesting thing. This film we're about to do is low budget, and it's still, I think we're adding $7 million for just COVID, you know, just for the testing and stuff. So things become prohibitive. And if you expand that out to a larger film with a larger cast and a larger crew and all that stuff, you know, the COVID costs become prohibitive, you know. So that's going to change. We're going to get, you know, we're going to go through about 4 months or so of some really bad times. I think it's going to get a lot darker before the dawn, but we have some adults in the room now, or going to be in the room now. And I believe that the testing is going to get better and faster, which will be the real key to getting us back, is properly accurate, rapid tests, so that we can, you know, stick a swab up your nose. If it's green, you can go to the concert. And if it's red, you go home. And it'll take probably about a year for us to really start to get immunized with these, inoculated with these vaccines. So it's going to be a while before we can start shooting in the way that would be fun. I went to, we screened the movie, this film, you know, we shot it on 65. It's designed to be seen on a big screen. And I hadn't seen it that way until last week. And we rented out the Village in Westwood on this giant screen with this great sound system. And just Grant and myself and two other people could go in there. And we walked into the theater, and there was posters in glass for A Quiet Place 2, which had just premiered in March and then couldn't open because of COVID. And it was like the Twilight Zone. We walked in, and it's like everything had stopped March 15th. And it's all just sitting there waiting to come back and, you know, and do it all again, which could be a while.
When you won the Cecil B. DeMille Award at the Golden Globes a few years ago, you said in your speech how lucky you are and how lucky everybody in that room is, and that you've got the brass ring, and mm-hmm. that brings responsibility with it, this mm-hmm. kind of privilege. And you've always lived up to this responsibility. You've been involved in a lot of causes, not just domestically, but internationally, thinking of South Sudan. What do you think, or what are you working on right now, or what do you think you will be working on with the state of the world now?
Well, I'm still, you know, I still raise several million dollars a year, and we continue to chase war criminals. Mostly we have sort of two versions. We have a foundation called The Century, which basically tries to bankrupt these guys because, you know, these guys are profiteering off of the misery of other people, South Sudan, the Congo, Sudan, lots of different places. So one of the most effective ways is we go to the banks, we show them, because these guys are using, you know, they're not using Sudanese pounds. They're exchanging money in dollars or euros or a British pound, mostly dollars though. And you're able to go to the banks and say, here's the evidence of the crimes they're committing and how they're profiting, and this is where their money is hidden. And I mean, we have these forensic accountants that we've, you know, hired away from the FBI. So we're able to chase them down and actually freeze their assets and give information to the Treasury Department, things like that. And then Amal and I, the Clooney Foundation, you know, we're in the middle of monitoring trials, because so many of these places that we were just talking about, you know, what's going on in Hong Kong right now with these, you know, these three young men who've been arrested for, you know, protesting these sort of draconian new laws that that mainland China is imposing. But we're monitoring that trial. And so we get people in to sit through the trials, because these guys, these groups, you know, hey, for instance, Aung San Suu Kyi, who we all thought was going to be a hero, who ends up being not so nice to the Rohingyas, we end up putting people inside those courtrooms because they're using courtrooms. Did it in Egypt. They do it. You go down a list. I mean, my God, Amal's representing Maria Reza now in the Philippines. They're using courtrooms with their judges to be able to give some semblance of a democratic judicial process where they go, well, we put them on trial. But of course, the judge is also the prosecutor, you know? And so we're basically in there monitoring them. Whether we can change the outcome or not is not necessarily the case, although sometimes we're going to be able to make it loud enough that it'll be hard, but basically to try to continually remind people that there has to be, you know, that the judicial system has to hold up in order for these governments to work. And to, you know, right now, as you look at it, the people who are doing the bad shit are getting away with it, and the people who are exposing them are going to jail. And so it's a big passion of my wife's and mine. And, you know, she's in the middle of trying to get some war criminals to the ICC, and she's in the middle of representing Maria Reza, who's this brilliant, she was a Time Person of the Year, a journalist who's facing the rest of her life in jail for reporting the truth about Duterte. And, you know, there's a lot of things like that that are going on in the world that sort of matter a lot. There's certainly a lot of things in the United States that are going on that matter as well. So, you know,
we could be talking about this forever, yeah. But I want to get back to a funny question.
Oh, good. Nice segue.
A few years ago, I visited you in your office in Los Angeles, and you had a Batman poster behind your desk. I don't know if it's still there, but I know for a fact this is not one of your favorite movies of yours. So why the Batman poster?
Well, first of all, I don't even think we have an office anymore. But yes, it was there for 20 years or so. It's because it's such a nice picture and I look so good in nipples. It's a cautionary tale. I'm actually very proud of that because that was a turning point in my career in a lot of ways, for a lot of reasons. It was, first of all, the biggest break I ever got in my life. You know, it was a huge break. I'd gone from doing television shows to doing studio films, and to play Batman was a big, big deal. Terrible film. I'm terrible in it. I know all of that. But at the time, it was a big deal. And also, the first time I'd gotten paid for any amount of money at all for a film. I was shocked because, you know, before that, I was being paid on a weekly basis, you know. And it was also a three-picture deal, which, since we didn't do more Batmans, it ended up being Three Kings and Syriana were the other two pictures, which were really worthy pictures to get made. But mostly it was, with the failure of that, I realized that, well, because before that I was just an actor and somebody offers you a job, you're like, yeah, you want to play Batman? Shit, yeah, I'll play Batman. You know, you want to, and what you realized was, finally, having been a journeyman actor for so long, was, oh, I'm going to get held responsible for the movie, not for my performance or not for being in it or what I do in it, but for the whole film being made. Because my name was, you know, at the top of the title. You know, Schwarzenegger, by the way, got paid $25 million to do that. You know, I just want to say.
You do know I'm not defending Arnold Schwarzenegger. I mean,
I know.
It's just honestly, only goes that far.
I didn't want to, you know, crap all over Arnold. He's a friend. I get along with him really well. He challenged me once to a drinking contest. He said, "You Irish, you can't drink. You can't drink." Yeah. And so we went to a place called Shotzi's or someplace he had.
Yes.
And he goes, "We're going to drink peach schnapps." I'm like, "Peach schnapps? Who drinks peach schnapps?" And it's clear and it's shocked. And it was 20 people around the table. Maria then was there. And they bring me the first shot and it's just like gasoline, you know, and I'm sure you've had it before. And I'm like, I'm never going to hang with this guy with that. So I went over to the waitress and I gave her $100. I said, "Just bring me shots of water." And she did okay. So I did like 20 shots of water and he drank 20 shots of schnapps. And his wife carried him out of the place. And to this day, he thinks I'm the greatest drinker he's ever met in his life. The Irish guy's got a hollow leg.
Hey, I have a little surprise for you. There's somebody in the room with us. She is the lead actress in Queen Sugar, shooting in New Orleans right now. Oh. And her very first acting job was in scenes with you. She was 12. Can we get Dawn Leanne Gardner in the room, please?
Hey.
Hi.
How are you? Well, you're not 12 anymore.
I'm not. I finally grew up into a grown person.
That's actually mind-blowing. How are you?
I'm good. It's good to see you. I can't remember that you even remember who I am.
Yeah. Well, so now what are you shooting there? What is it?
So I'm shooting a show called Queen Sugar. It's Ava DuVernay's first TV project.
Oh, great. And,
yeah. It's the adventure of shooting in COVID.
I haven't done it yet. Is it just like time consuming?
Yes, it is time consuming. It's basically the opposite sort of culture of production culture. Production culture is like, hurry up, hurry up, hurry up. And COVID culture is like, please slow down so we don't die.
Are you in a bubble of some form or?
Yeah, it's like a bubble like situation. So I'm quarantined in a hotel at this moment in New Orleans. And I've basically been here for about a month and a half now, shooting sort of in a pod of sorts. Yeah. They've done an amazing job with basically orienting the whole season to keep us very safe.
It's tough too, because it's not a movie, it's a show. So it goes on longer.
That's right.
And it's also a funny thing, as you know, as an actor, you know, there is this funny thing. You'll be out in the elements and the whole crew is covered, like they look like Kenny in South Park. You can only see like their nose.
Right.
And you're out there with nothing on, like shaking. Right. So And it's the same thing here. I mean, you know, there's love scenes, there's interaction, there's all these things. Is that also, how big is your cast? Is it a big cast?
Well, they actually this year rewrote, they had the entire season. We stopped filming like episode two, basically at the beginning of episode two in March. And so they had the whole season all written and ready to go. And of course they had to like throw it all out and rewrite it. And they included COVID in the storyline. So, and that's, you know, something that Ava was, I think it's really exciting actually in terms of what this year has been, especially for, you know, Black folks in this country. So it's been a really rich opportunity in that way for storytelling, but it also completely compressed the cast. So now instead of having scenes with extras and whatever else, it's literally for a good 2 to 3 weeks, it was me and one other person just shooting our stuff. And then another pod of cast that is shooting their stuff and then the pod of cast shooting their stuff. So that's how they figured it out. But I mean, that can't last for many, many seasons. So we're going to have to figure out, you know, I know that other productions are doing it differently where they're not shooting a COVID storyline necessarily. And they've got to figure out things like, you know, bigger cast.
Also, how many productions have we also shut down because of one mistake and one, I mean, it's the NBA who really set the high bar. They're the ones.
I know.
Oh, this is actually
what I want to know is, in those scenes in ER, what was your disease and what did you cure, George?
What was your disease? I don't remember the disease.
I had asthma and I was and my mom couldn't pay for the medicine. And then I think your character arranged for, like, you met her at the apartment building or something with the medicine.
Oh, I remember. Yeah, I want. Yeah, we shot that in Chicago, actually, that sequence of me walking up the building. We shot in what was then Cabrini Green, which was sort of a rough neighborhood, which has all been completely gentrified now.
What's crazy is that the woman who played my mom back then, I ended up doing a theater show with her years later. And we were, you know, sitting across from each other going like, where do I know you from?
Yeah, you were my mom. By the way, I'm like that with my real parents. I think I know you guys. I'm able to see. And so how do you stay in touch with, because you're in New Orleans and there is a film community there, but is it all just Zooms and FaceTimes and stuff with your family and friends?
Yeah, it is. I mean, I feel like not much has changed except I get picked up by a van, go to set, and I come back still quarantined and I still can't, you know, go out and do all the things that we want to do.
And in New Orleans, it's really not fair because it's a town made for.
It's crazy not fair. And it's been interesting, I think, just sort of observing the city from my little balcony at my hotel and seeing the shifts even now, right? Like it's definitely not the same hustling and bustling and, you know, city that it is without COVID there. It's shifted. But there's always this like sort of mischievous beating heart to the city. It's just like that can never.
Well, even after Katrina, where New Orleans took such a hard hit, you know, the idea was always that we can take it, we'll bounce back. You know, you keep seeing when you hear Trump go, New York's dead, you know, probably dead to him from now on. but you know, great cities have a heartbeat that, you know, that tragedies don't defeat them. You know, they, in fact, they take pride in the fact that they don't. New Orleans is going to be bouncing back in a big, beautiful way. It's going to take a period of time and it's going to be frustrating and we're all going to go a little nuts for a bit. Listen, I'm going nuts. Look at this. Look, you know, you won't remember because I was only in my 30s then. But now look at the shit that I'm reading all day long. It's Fun at the Fair, Peppa's First Sleepover, Peppa's New Neighbors.
I feel like COVID is the great equalizer for parents.
Dragon Glove Tacos, very important.
Yeah.
One.
Yeah.
Yes. Oh, it's key. This is what my life is now. So, you know, it's really been, you know, nothing but fun for me. But, you know, we're all in the same thing together. It's exciting that you get to be working. I think that's.
It actually has been like an incredible thing that they've been able to pull off. I feel like not even just for us to be able to, you know, make our living, and but also for the hundreds of other people. It's really for the hundreds of other people that productions employ, and how much we've all been hurting, and we all, you know, need to not just be of service, but also make what everyone's relying on. Everyone's relying on entertainment these days to get through it. Everyone.
I mean, you know, Netflix is Netflix hit the jackpot. You know,
yeah, they're like, that's exactly right.
You know, we have a, you know, we have a service that can that everyone can, you know, turn on and have, you know, and lose all of their, you know, worries for a couple of hours, which is amazing. So that must be, so it must be fun to be there then, at least. It's not, where do you live normally, LA?
Yeah, I'm normally, I'm an LA native. So normally I'm in LA, yeah.
Well, I mean, LA's, you know, LA, we're lucky because it's, the weather's usually warm enough that we can still function somewhat outside, but.
Yeah. Well, in, similar in New Orleans, you know, I mean, there's been some colder days, but it's also been lovely and pleasant. And I just feel very lucky that I can go outside and not feel angry that it's so cold that I can't feel my toes and such, you know?
Yeah, that's what I'm going through.
But you're in Austria.
Oh my God.
Yeah.
She knows nothing
but a lockdown in Austria.
Yep. So I can, but I can't go outside. I can go into nature, which is nice. But this was great that you guys got to like, that I could bring you together. It was kind of a funny story.
Well, I got Don, check in every 25 years, will you?
Well, George,
hopefully we'll all be together in New Orleans soon.
And, I do want to take the opportunity because I don't know if it's going to be another 25 years before I ever see you via Zoom or have another moment. But I just want to thank you because I do remember, first of all, my 12-year-old memory, like what the memory I have of you is this incredibly gracious human. You were such a gracious human. And I remember learning a lot, even at 12, of this is how you help a set feel comfortable, safe, good, all those things. But I also want to thank you because I think for me, you have been an example and maybe were the first example of someone who really was using your voice and your platform and your public sort of space to point an arrow to the conversations that mattered most to you and to the conversations that were not necessarily getting the airtime that they deserve in terms of what, you know, what's happening in our social spaces, what's happening in the world. So I just wanted to say really from the bottom of my heart, it's been one of my beacons to watch how you've created that and constructed that and never backed away from it. It's defined, you know, a lot of what you've stood for. And I just really thank you for that example.
Well, that couldn't be a nicer thing to say. And, you know, I would tell you the truth is I was only nice to 12-year-olds.
You guys, I have to turn this over to some questions from the room. So Don, thank you so much for joining us.
Bye.
Our first question comes from Alexa Georges.
Hello, Alexa.
Am I unmuted? Am I there? I can't.
Yes. I can't see your face, but I see your name.
Hey, there I am.
Hey, all right.
I had to move locations. My husband came home. He was having lunch. He was making all this noise. So anyway, so George, I see you and Elisabeth are pretty much longtime friends. And, you know, in the South, we love a good story. Juicier the better. Just curious, how did you and Elisabeth meet?
Well, it's a long story. It was a Turkish bath.
I knew you were going to do this.
No, Elisabeth and I met years ago. She's with the Hollywood Foreign Press. And we met when I was doing ER, actually, way back in, probably 94 or 95. And there
93.
It was 93, I guess. Yeah, you're probably right. And Warner Brothers at the time, you remember this? Warner Brothers was boycotting the Hollywood Foreign Press.
Yep.
And I was like, you know, what's the reason? They had some screwed up reason. I was like, you know, I think it's time that we have a detente. And then I met you and talked with you about it. And you were like, this is the most ridiculous, you know, argument between two groups we've ever seen. And so Elisabeth and I worked hard at sort of brokering a peace agreement between them. And we've been friends ever since. We, you know, Elisabeth comes and works. I do these Nespresso commercials Then I use the money to pay for our foundation. And Elisabeth is the journalist on the set who comes and does interviews, light interviews, nothing too heavy.
What's your favorite coffee flavor?
Exactly. I mean, we don't delve too deeply into, you know, world politics on that. But so we've worked together. I don't know how many of those have we done, 20 or something together?
16, I think.
Yeah, it's a huge amount of them. So we've been seeing each other on and off for, that's a lot, 27 years. I haven't aged at all.
Yep. Me neither.
Exactly the same.
Me neither. We still drink the same amount.
Exactly.
Tequila.
Thank you.
Yeah, well, you know, it's my product. I have to.
Yeah, that's true. I'm going to Lori Oxner, who also has a question.
Let's see where Lori is.
Yeah, this is the thing with the new technology that we're living in. We always have to fill the gaps between the... Is Lori still there?
Well, I have different hats I could wear. I have my wife's hat I could put on.
Oh, nice. Lori is here.
Well, it's New Orleans, so I felt like...
She needs to be unmuted. Okay.
Let's see. You got to hit that.
Yeah.
There you go.
Yes, we can hear you.
Hello.
Okay, good. That hat actually works with my question because you are known for your pranks.
Yes.
You saw the Today Show this morning talking about how Brad Pitt got you in Lake Como.
So, I got him back.
I know. So what's your best prank that you got somebody back, whether it's Brad or anybody?
Well, Brad, I did some pretty awful things to, but he'd done some awful things to me. The first one I did to him to get him back was he was driving, like it was when Priuses had first come out, and he was very, you know, it was all very environmentally sort of elegant. I think the first Prius we ever saw. And I found a bumper sticker in the shape of a pot plant that I hope we were allowed to say this on this, that said, fuck cops. And I put it on the back of his car because there's just no way you're not going to get pulled over with a bumper sticker that says that. We get pulled over and he's like, what's up, man? And they're like, what's wrong with you? And he's like, and he hadn't seen it. So there was that. And I also had stationery made up with his name on it and sent letters to actors from him with his stationery on it. They were just insane letters. I sent Meryl Streep a binder full of CDs. This guy had made, it was like Frank, you know, something, Frank Smith, Voices for the Stage and Screen. And each page would be like, this is Gaelic and this is a French accent, to teach you how to do accents. And I took that binder of things, it must have been 100 different, it's a huge thing. And I send it to Meryl Streep with a card from Brad with his name on it, said, I hear you're gonna do the Iron Lady soon. This guy helped me with my accent in Troy. And he goes, so I thought maybe he could help you. And then I never told her, you know, and so that I've done some really awful things. Believe me, he's deserved everything he's gotten. So, you know.
Thank you, Lori. So next up are Bobby Gilchrist and Kelly Murtaugh. I guess they
Hi. Hello.
Hey guys.
My name is Kelly Murtaugh.
Hi, Bobby. How are you?
Living in the blurry land of kids' books, and this is our office.
We're in our playroom now.
You know, it's just, it is what it is.
I'm sorry. I'm busy right now.
Oh, we know that book. We love Dragons Love Tacos.
It's a good one.
So we are both actors. We're also filmmakers. We're in post-production for our first feature. That's going to be done in like a month. And we're ready to let it leave the nest.
Can't wait.
If you want a link, we'll send you one.
Awesome.
We got it in New Orleans back in 2019. Thankfully, we're in post and we're not, you know, shut down. So our question is, how does your acting experience or Yes, your acting experience and all of those years that you had, how did that lend itself and inform your other creative endeavors, directing, producing, writing?
Well, it helps a lot, obviously, because, you know, you're on a set, first of all. The things you learn as an actor as you go, one of the things you'll learn, and you guys are filmmakers now, so you'll understand this, is that you cannot make a good film out of a bad script. You can make a bad film out of a good script. I've been involved in that before. So first and foremost, it always comes down to writing. It doesn't matter what it is, the writing has to work. If it doesn't, and I've done films where the writing doesn't work, and the slog it is to try to find a way to make it work is really hard. So it's writing first. Then it's sort of a director shooting with the point of view. Were you both directing it together?
I wrote it and I starred in it.
We were just EPs.
And we were EPs. So we didn't direct it. I couldn't think
about it. All right, so let me ask you, how was that experience for you? Because writing something and handing it off to someone else sometimes can be very frustrating as well, right?
Yes, I will say our director, Samantha Aldana, who is involved with New Orleans Film Society, she and I spent a year in development. It's a personal story of mine and about my experience with an eating disorder. And anyway, point being is that she thankfully was very integral and sort of giving me permission to go there, because I was filtering myself while I was writing. I was like, well, we can't do a scene like this, even though this happened in my real life. People don't want to watch that. And she just kind of gave me this sense of, I just want to just go there, just write it, just do it, just don't hinder your imagination, which really opened me up.
Just honestly tell a story about eating disorders that hasn't been told yet.
Body horror way, which is cool. But
is your goal to continue writing?
Acting, producing, writing, maybe, but I think my strengths as an artist lie more in acting and improv and producing, that kind of thing. I mean, I love scripts, I love writing, but.
Okay, so, but let me throw this out for both of you in this part of the game. My version of it was, I started as an actor. I always liked the idea of writing and I always wrote bits. And when you start on sitcoms, you are always writing a little bit. You're always going, oh, I can fix this scene. How about if I say this? And so you're repairing things, which is kind of a good way to get into writing, is just helping out, fixing things. But what became really clear by the time I was in my sort of mid 30s was I was concerned with the idea that my only contribution to this industry that I really love is going to become dependent upon what some casting director thinks of me at 60, you know? Mm-hmm. And knowing that you can't start writing and directing and producing at 60, which is too late, my goal was you have a trailer when you're working on the set. I never was in my trailer. I used to say I'm from Kentucky. We try to stay out of trailers. You know, it's not something we brag about. I was always on the set, always, because I wanted to have more control over my career. And you can have more control when you are executive producing, as you're doing, producing, writing, directing, all of those other elements. Doesn't mean you give up on acting at all, but it does mean that you continually open to these other elements if you have the interest. I have lots of friends. My friend Richard Kind, who's a wonderful actor, he doesn't want to direct or produce. He wants to act. He loves it. And he's a wonderful actor and he'll work forever. So there's a lot of different, but if it's in you to do that, it's really important that you've started now and that you continue to feed that beast, because that's the thing that gets you a little bit more independence later in your career. You know, it's just an important thing to keep in mind, but it's exciting. I mean, look, it must be a very exciting time to be a month away from giving birth to your, you know, to a story that's so personal, you know?
Thank you. We are very excited. We're starting to, you know, submit to some film festivals and IFP. Oh, we were we were chosen to be in IFP, which is the Independent Filmmakers Project, one of six narratives. They only were able to do six narratives this year. So thankfully You know, we got some things churning. We're ready to.
Exciting, man. You guys, look, this is a fun business to be in. You know, what the big secret about all this crap is that, you know, we have done it for free and we would do it for free because we get to not grow up.
Yes.
You know, we get to still be kids. And so, you know, while I'm reading Dragons Love Tacos to my kids, you know, I'm as entertained by that book as they are. There's an element of us that, you know, still gets to play make believe. And I think that we're really lucky to be able to do that. And I think that you must feel the same way. And I'm really excited for you guys for this next step. It's a, you know, it's harrowing, particularly one that where you're talking about such personal subject matter, but it's exciting. It's exciting to say, look, this is what I created. And it's hard now. Remember, when you're an actor, people kind of, they can crap on your performance a little bit, kind of hurts. But when you're a writer or a director, they hold you responsible for everything, right? They are like, you know, they question your intelligence and they question, what are you trying to say? And just know, you know, there's always going to be, you know, we're in a world now where it's just as fun to be mean as it is to be nice on the internet in particular. So, you know, just be, steel yourself for all of it, because it's going to be an exciting run for you. I'm very excited for you. Congratulations. Well,
thank you so much.
We have, I think, two or three more questions. One is Fritz. Is Fritz in the room?
Did you pick him because he's Austrian?
No, he's Norlinian. I mean, he doesn't sound like me at all.
Well, if the name Fritz is anything to do with it.
The German coast. You know, New Orleans has a German coast. What can I say? Hi, Fritz. Go ahead.
Hi. Thank you for doing this, George.
Hey, Fritz. There we go. Got white beard, white hair. Oh, I feel like I'm with my people.
My grandfather's from Hamburg, so it's close to Austria.
Yeah, I know. It wasn't far.
I wanted to ask, you've done several movies now that have a space, you know, theme about future technologies in space. And yeah. What is your personal feeling on the whole? I mean, we've now got the third richest man on the planet putting all this money into Mars. What's your personal feeling on the idea of Mars and us ever becoming colonizing and all that stuff?
Well, I'm a kid of the 60s. And so for me, everything was about the trip to the moon when I was growing up. When I was 7 years old, I was wearing a space suit and eating space food sticks and drinking Tang. And, you know, this thing that we have here is a result, a direct result of all of the technology that we learned trying to put a man on the moon. So I believe in it wholeheartedly. You know, I believe in the ideas of looking forward and looking out, because I believe in, you know, with that, all the other things that come with it. You know, I'd like us to take a little bit better care of this planet rather than trying desperately to live on, you know, another one. But I'm all for any of that kind of stuff. You know, the guy that runs around sort of spouting off things like calling people the pedo guy is now the third richest man in the world. That's a whole other issue. But the idea of looking forward, I've never seen it not work. You know, I've always seen it advance us, whether it was looking forward into traveling across the oceans. You know, if you've ever gone to Tahiti, which I've been to once, and think about how some guys got in a boat, and, you know, maybe 25 people got in a boat and they started sailing. And if you look out, you go, what were you thinking? And they end up landing in Hawaii, you know, and sort of colonizing in Hawaii and stuff. And you think, who thought that? And whose mind thought, well, let's go here, let's try this, with all the elements against you. And so I'm always a fan of the idea of looking forward and looking outward, because most of the time it says so much about us and what we get to be and what we can develop from. We learn a lot from travel. You know, there's a, you know, and this will take it to a completely different direction, but so you understand sort of what I mean. After World War II, you know, we as a country, for the first time, World War I somewhat, but World War II in particular, we traveled, we all had passports, and we got to see the world, and we came home with French cuisine and Italian, you know, food, and with all of these different cultures and art, and it became a big part of American culture. And we weren't afraid of anything. We weren't afraid to try or do anything because nothing scared us. We'd seen all of these things that could have been frightening. Then, two generations later, very few people have passports anymore. And suddenly all of these elements, these countries and these people, the Muslims over there, or the, suddenly they can be demonized or made scary because we haven't been there and seen them. And so you're able to sort of, you're able to scare people in a way and close your world down. So I'm a big believer in expanding wherever and whenever we can to see and be around, whether it's other people or other societies or other worlds. I'm a big believer in there's only good that comes out of it, you know?
Thanks, great. Bobby. Thanks. I mean, Fritz, I have, we have time for one more question, and that goes to Susanna Coolidge.
Susanna.
Hi.
Susanna, hi, she's here. We can hear her and now we can see her. Hi.
Since you're a producer and a storyteller, I was wondering if it's difficult for you sometimes to read something nonfiction or fiction and not think of it as movie material, with the exception of the dragons and tacos, maybe, I don't know.
I think it'd make a hell of a movie, I'm telling you. I don't know why those dragons like tacos, but they like them. Yeah, you know, it's funny. There's, you know, articles in general have been a big source for us for films. Argo is an article. A lot of news articles are sort of have been really interesting ways to get films. We've also adapted, Grant and I are now adapting a John Grisham book for Bob Dylan, which is a pretty fun thing. So we got hired by Bob Dylan to adapt a John Grisham book, which, you know, if you told me that when I was, you know, listening to Bob Dylan when I was 15 years old, you could have, you bowl me over. But reading material in general, you know, I like to read stuff just to read it. It's really hard to always think, oh, this would make a great movie. I mean, you know, read Catcher in the Rye and you go, this actually, if somebody did it right, it would be a great movie. It'll never get made. And Salinger said no, and I get that one. So when you read that one every once in a while, you go, God, this would be like To Kill a Mockingbird. This would be, but most of the time I can read something and just say, you know, what a tremendous story. I tend to read nonfiction. I kind of like that better. And usually if you're reading nonfiction, there's some version of that story that's been told, you know, at some point. But I don't know, do you when you read books, do you think, God, this would make a great film? Is that, do you go through that?
Yeah, sometimes.
You do, yeah. Yeah, I do too. I mean, sometimes. I've also read some books where I go, I'm going to kill this author if it doesn't, if they don't land this thing the right way, you know? But you know, books, Lily, who wrote this book, wrote us a beautiful letter about the movie and said, it's such a fascinating thing to see the process from a book to, you know, all the way through to the, through the screenplay written by another writer to then interpretation of the screenplay by the director and the actors. And it does change, you know, 3 days of the Condor was 6 days of the Condor as a book. You know, there is a, you know, things get compressed and, you know, characters get pushed together and stuff like that. But But a lot of times, I think it's, you know, you kind of want to give yourself a break and just read stuff to read it, you know, not to just be looking for work.
Thank you. That's the end, actually. Midnight Sky is coming out on Netflix in December.
Yes.
And we hope people enjoy the rest of the 2020 New Orleans Film Festival. Go stream lots of great films online and consider donating.
How are you doing it? Are you? How many films are they screening? Are there a lot for the festival?
165, I believe, are being streamed. And the New Orleans Film Society also generated some donations so that 1,200 low-income households in New Orleans, in the New Orleans area, can watch those for free.
Great. Wow, that's fantastic. But
there's a big...
That's a lot of films to watch, you guys. Good luck.
And host. And maybe some of you that are on here are watching us can possibly consider donating if you have a little money left to the New Orleans Film Society to support the independent filmmakers, because they have really amazing programs. And everyone here, thank you, Circle members, and everyone watching at home.
Yeah, thank you, guys.
Give a big wave to George. And thank you, George, for being with us.
And everybody be safe and know that we're going to all get through this. This is that moment, you know, where sort of the great qualities of mankind eventually will take hold. And we're all going to get through this together. And we're all going to be in the same room sometime soon. So stay healthy. Be careful.
Beautiful words. Thank you. Stay healthy. Party in 2022.
Good. Okay.
Bye, everybody.
Bye.